All right, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming my guest at this time, the World Wrestling Federation's Intercontinental Champion, Bret the Hitman Hart.
Take a long standing ovation here for the Hitman.
They know talent when they see it, Brian.
He ever comb his hair?
He did. It is combed. That's the new look.
Michael Jackson's even trying to look like the Hitman.
You know, Bret Hart, it wasn't that long ago. I remember it very vividly in Indianapolis at WrestleMania when you once again captured the World Wrestling Federation's IC title, a very hard-fought victory for you.
You know, for me, Gene, WrestleMania 8 was probably the toughest, absolutely the toughest match that I've ever had. Everybody knows, you know, I know, and all you people know that I came about this close to getting my bell rung.
Did you ever?
But you know something? For all the times that my father has been in my corner, I just like to say, for all the times that he's backed me up, that I just want to dedicate this belt to him. Happy 77th birthday, Dad.
Get
this one is for you.
What a nice gesture.
And of course, I've watched your career, and I'm very well aware of your family, your mother, Helen, your father, Stu, one of the all-time greats. Right now, you're on cloud nine, you're riding sky high, but there is one individual here on the World Wrestling Federation who is trying to upset the apple cart, so to speak. He happens to be the number one contender for this title. You know I'm talking about Shawn Michaels. Did I say something wrong?
You know, it's kind of funny, Gene, we talk about Shawn Michaels, you know? Because when I think of Shawn Michaels, sometimes he kind of reminds me of me. You know, you got to give Shawn Michaels a lot of credit. He's a great, great wrestler. He's got a lot of ability. He's a little unfocused, but he's got a lot of ability. He's got some really, really great moves. He's fast. You know, you don't know where to start sometimes. He's got a tremendous amount of ability. But there's two real, real big differences between me and Shawn Michaels.
What are those differences, Bret Hart?
Well, the first one is, I don't gotta pay my women to go out with me.
Oh, oh yeah!
I don't believe you should have told that one.
And the second big difference between me and Shawn Michaels is, Shawn Michaels, you don't have this, and you're never, ever gonna get it.
It'll be a classic confrontation when it does go down. Stay with us. We'll be back with the Nasty Boys.
His mom's name is Stu.
Got a pair of the Hitman shades.
I'm kind of child there. And they're just waiting. Kind of silently waiting for the first opening thing, and you're going to hear bursts of applause from this audience. The match has so far been so well received. There you go.
They're not too thrilled with Dino Bravo. I'll tell you, someone who's watching with great anticipation this match, you can bet on it, Alfred, and that's Shawn Michaels.
Yes, indeed. And he really wants to get at Bret Hart. And I think of all the wrestlers at the moment in the WWF, I think Shawn Michaels has the right ploy in mind to be able to take away that Intercontinental belt from Bret Hart, should he still retain it after this match, of course.
Well, this match, as we stated earlier on, tremendous significance. The title is definitely on the line. But regardless of whether he loses the title or not, he will still make an appearance in what, just under 2 weeks now, out there in Long Beach, California, at the Personal Fitness Expo on June 13th and 14th, along with a whole host of other stars in WWF. And what a weekend that's going to be. And kicking it all off, of course, the big WWF championships, with a new champion to be crowned 1992 at the Long Beach Convention Center. And it's all available on pay-per-view. It's amazing.
It really is amazing. Tell me, what other World Wrestling Federation superstars are going to be there?
Well, I understand that the Ultimate Warrior, Texas Tornado, Animal and Hawk of Legion of Doom, Sergeant Slaughter, Crush. Believe that, Crush? What a powerhouse that guy is.
Yes.
He might have entered the tournament himself.
Well, I was just thinking of Legion of Doom there when you were talking about that. Animal and Hawk, if they went into that and entered for it, I'm sure they'd come out first and second.
Well, it's kind of tough. You take a look at those WWF stars, Your Lordship, and they have devoted their entire life to doing nothing but that.
Yes.
And you have to if you want to be successful. In other words, they're unemployed, Albert.
Yes, absolutely. But they work so hard.
Oh, look at that.
They were.
High cross body, Dino down, but Hitman really not inverted. Atomic drop of beauty.
And, of course, their physiques are very classical, too. They're like Adonis's Greek gods, those weightlifters and bodybuilders.
They certainly are.
They develop each muscle to perfection. And they are so exciting to see, especially when they're posing. And they're going to be really taking on each other. There should be some very, very good posing routines.
You look for last year's winner to repeat, Alfred?
I don't know about that. I mean, he's worked out very, very hard indeed. But as I said some time ago to, I believe it was to you, I'm not quite sure about that, but I like the Mighty Quinn.
How about Gary Stridham? Was he the winner last year?
Yes, Stridham was, you know.
Well, I just saw a photo of him not too long ago in a magazine. He looked terrific.
Yes, he does. Robinson looks
so did the girls that were with him in the photo today.
Yes, the flexing Dutchman, he looks good too.
Oh, Barry DeMay, one of the big stars. A big star over here in Europe, too.
Yes, absolutely. I wouldn't mind betting he's been here to Munich and to many other big... Because in Germany, you know, bodybuilding is so big. And I've seen many people reading our magazine, the World Bodybuilding Federation magazine, which is a great magazine. Well, at the moment, Bravo doing very, very well here against Bret Hart. I really did expect Bret Hart to start picking Bravo apart at the seams. He hasn't managed to do that yet. The big Frenchman has a lot of power, a lot of strength in his upper body and his lower body comes to that, those tree trunk-like legs. But Hart, I'm sure he's going to pick out one particular part sooner or later and just dedicate himself to that.
Just ran over him like a steamroller there. Hitman not doing his job. Got to use that speed, that agility, that quickness. Instead, he's playing right into Bravo's hand with a power moves. Hitman well executed. And another inverted atomic drop finds the mark. Boy, that'll make it difficult to sit down later.
Yes. Bret Hart seems to be playing some sort of a chess game here with Bravo. Doing various moves, moving ahead about three or four moves. And then applying them, and now he's settled into a nice pattern here.
Boy, that's the last thing I'd want to do is play any kind of games with Dino Bravo, who could take you out of the picture in a hurry.
Yes, he can, and he uses a few primitive holds as well, Dino Bravo, that are not probably in the book of wrestling. He uses those effectively, so Bret Hart has to watch a lot here, but at the moment, he seems quite confident to me.
Nice shot of this capacity crowd here in the Olympia Hall, as I think it's pronounced.
Yes, right.
I would say hall, but they want to call it a hall. It's
yes.
Perfectly all right with me.
It's not so bad, is it?
No, definitely not.
No.
It's amazing how quickly you can pick up a language if you're, you know, spend any time at all over here.
Yes, I'd like to put in a
especially
few,
if you want to get any groceries.
Yeah, a few Dunkershins and a few Petershins.
Absolutely.
And bowlers see my hair.
And same to you.
And I believe that fellow there, Tim White, the third man, is referred to as an Arbiter.
An Arbiter.
Yes.
He resembles that remark, doesn't it?
And the two contestants are ringers.
The ringers?
And this is the ringer, wrestling.
Oh, okay.
I learned all those words, you know.
We've got a few ringers, I know that for sure. Bravo looking for a clean break out of the corner here. And the referee. Oh. I'm very uncharacteristic of the Hitman. Whoa!
Oh, my word!
Oh, did he hit that corner?
Oh, he shifted the whole ring then. a few inches or so, and this is a heavy, heavy steel ring. Picking his spot, Bravo. And I believe that Hart has been really badly hurt. But he came to his feet a bit quickly there. I'd watch him if I were Bravo.
Gave away a lot of poundage in this one. Oh, pile driver. Not all that well executed, but certainly took a lot of starch out of the Hitman. Very nonchalant cover here by Dino Bravo. Not going to be the champion that way.
No. He's given to a little bit of showboating once he gets on top, Bravo. But you don't get on top and stay on top too long against a fellow like Bret Hart.
Well, I understand, Alfred, that the longer this one goes, the more it's going to be in favor of the Hitman, because Dino Bravo, as you can quite easily see, has taken off about 25 or 30 pounds here in the last 3 or 4 months in preparation for this European rampage, and that takes a lot out of you.
It certainly does, but at the same time, he looks awfully fit to me. Bret Hart, his stamina has never been in question. He's without a doubt one of the fittest men I have ever seen in the World Wrestling Federation, and all that has paid off for him in Excelsis.
And I think, too, when the tank starts to get empty on the Hitman, he reaches down for that little something extra, something that's inbred, your lordship.
Yes.
Something that, you know, you just don't go out and buy or train or learn how to do. It's just inside you. You either have it or you don't have it. And in my book, Dino Bravo doesn't have it.
Do you think that's something to do with the strains, the genes from the old man?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. It's all in the genes, Alfred.
Yes. And another thing, he has tremendous courage. And there is one proverb that really goes without saying in wrestling. There is no honor without courage. And Bret has certainly reaped in the honors for himself. His courage is also well attested.
Certainly has, and he's paying for it right now, because everybody guns for the champion. And gunning for him right now, waiting, is Shawn Michaels.
Yes. This is a bit of a surprise to you, Gorilla, the fact that Bravo is doing a lot better than we thought he would, or what?
Well, I never figured that he wouldn't give the Hitman a run for his money. You know, here's a guy that's had gold around his waist, former Canadian heavyweight champion, plus a few tag team titles along the way, and Dino Bravo, no slouch. Look at this, went to that old patented bear hug of his, and the Hitman's paying the price right now as... I don't think he's trying to squeeze the air out of him so much as to do some further damage to that lower back and kidney area where he shot the Hitman earlier on so hard into that turnbuckle.
Yes, he's trying to brutalize him there. You're so right, Gorilla. And Dino Bravo, obviously very, very confident to come in such close physical contact with Hart, who is known to have a multitude of various counterholds, especially from a primitive hold like that.
You know, certainly would be a long ride home on the plane, your lordship, if you were to lose your title here.
Oh, my word.
I'd consider taking a ship.
Well, I wonder if the Intercontinental title has ever changed hands ever in a foreign country such as Germany before, here in Europe.
Well, I don't think so. I know it was originally won the first time in Rio de Janeiro in South America, but I don't believe it was ever lost overseas any time thereafter. I could be wrong. This is no gimme right here.
Bret Hart decided to give him a little tit for tat there, some of his own medicine back. Earlier on, Bravo tried to take a chunk out of the Hitman. I guess the Hitman was just waiting for that opportunity to repay him.
Well, now that fatigue factor is starting to set in.
Wow.
Oh, patented side suplex. That's what he puts the opponents away with, but now put on a rope by the Hitman, who knew exactly where he was.
Yes, his geographical knowledge of that rope terrain and there, the square, is so good. It saved him many times. It certainly saved him there. And Dino showing sharp signs of frustration.
Boy, is he bent out of shape.
And a little more quickly out of that hole now. Hitman, I believe, is getting his second or third wind. And look at that look of determination, of grit there on his face. He's really determined to hang in.
Well, it's amazing what you can do when the title's on the line, but right now he's paying the price with this bear hug as Dino Bravo just keeps squeezing and squeezing, and the Hitman, for all intents and purposes, is fading.
Yes, I think he's gone back to that back situation again, Gorilla. You're right, he's not trying to cut off any wind. He's not trying to crush the lungs, he's going for the lower back.
Well, in this particular matchup, as tough as it is, Hitman only has to worry about what's in front of him, where somewhere down the line, you know, Your Lordship, he's going to have to face Shawn Michaels. He's going to have to worry about what's going on behind his back with Scary Sherry out there on the floor.
That's absolutely true. I wonder if that's affected his performance here today. I wonder if that's been uppermost on his mind, because Michaels has really been hounding him.
Well, I'm sure he's had a few sleepless nights. Irish Whip coming up. Bravo in. Backdrop of beauty. Whoa, the big guy came down hard. Right on that coccyx bone. And only a two count.
Oh, but very, very close indeed. Dino Bravo has surprised everybody here with this show of strength, this show of power.
Another suplex and another quick cover, but Bravo, with those powerful legs, kicks out easily. Right hand, another right hand, down in the breadbasket this time. Reversal.
Oh, gosh. Oh, sternum first into that turnbuckle.
Just when you think you got Bravo where you want him, he makes a fool out of you. Oh, beautifully executed backbreaker by the Hitman. Where's he going? Second turnbuckle on the inside. Oh, elbow right across the sternum. He knocked him silly. Holy mackerel. Let's go up and get the official word.
Here is the winner.
Of this Intercontinental Champion, and what an effort he put forth. Let's go back and take a look at some of the fantastic action that went down in this one, and give it to me, Your Lordship.
Well, Bret Hart played a very intelligent war here against Dino Bravo. He played a defensive battle. He knew he couldn't take him away in the first few minutes, so he saved and waited very
Who's the boss now? Boss man, that was the first beating in a long line of beatings. You're in my prison now, but I have thrown away the key, and there's nothing you can do about it, and no one can stop me now.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, my guest this week is certainly one of the most bizarre men to ever enter the World Wrestling Federation. Ladies and gentlemen, Papa Shango.
Well, this will be interesting to say the least.
I agree.
You never know what to expect. This guy's made a believer out of a number of individuals in the WWF.
They're all waiting for something, to happen.
I can tell you Mean Gene must be shaking in his boots at this moment.
Size of this guy.
You know, recently, Papa Shango, you put that hex, that spell, that curse of yours on the Ultimate Warrior. And we all waited.
Papa Shango will reign over the Warrior's demise!
Then, the next week, Papa Shango, the Ultimate Warrior, was victorious over his... There is more to the story. The next week, the Ultimate Warrior, standing, by the way, as close to me as you are right now, proclaimed himself free, of your curse. When all of a sudden... This liquid, this evil goo, began to trickle down his face, totally covering his facade.
Papashango. Most recently, your dark spell was felt by yet another opponent. I can't imagine for the life of me what this man must have felt when he found himself in the center of the ring with his feet on fire. And that evil goo all over. Papashango, I've got to ask you, what is going on?
Ultimate Warrior, how does it feel not to be in control? Ultimate Warrior, how does it feel? You have entered the dark world of Papashango. You have stepped into my black circle. And that circle, it's closing on you.
Thank God that's over.
Mean Gene Okerlund thanking his lucky stars that nothing happened out there. Wait a minute. What is that? Look, it's the curse of Papashango. What is going on?
I have never seen anything like this before. Wow.
Oh, my God.
Youngsters, feet were on fire, and all that black goo coming out of his forehead. Give me a break. Will you get up? Get out from under there. What are you doing under the table?
I can hear fine from down here.
Get up. You can't see anything from down there.
I don't want to see anything, Monsoon. Everything's just fine down here.
This is the first time since Papashango started all this curse stuff.
I'll tell you.
That we've had a jump. Will you stop?
I'll tell you something. That goo means something.
Well, why
don't
you leave?
Goo means something. It happened to the warrior. It happened to the guy with the feet smoking and the feet on the flames. Something's happening.
Not right. We've got a couple of guys standing by here.
And the funny thing about it is, the Ultimate Warrior seems like he's not afraid of this man. He's too dumb to be afraid of
this
man.
He's not dumb. He's taking everything this guy can throw at him, and is still hanging in there. Look at the look on that youngster's face.
Warner!
Seems a little apprehensive. He's probably had maybe one or two matches.
Obviously more guts than brains.
Yeah, but he's not moving too quick. I don't know if I was a 20-year-old kid, maybe had one or two matches under my belt, if I'd want to step in the ring with this guy, I don't care how much money I'd be making or what big star I'd be on the WWF television network, I don't think I'd get in the ring.
Well, you're only a short run away from the youngster. Why don't you go down there and get him?
This is as far, as close as... I'm fine here.
How can you even see anything? Get off your knees.
I can see through the reflection on yours.
Oh, please.
Would you say this Hammond Anchor's a little apprehensive?
Yeah, just a wee bit. I'm sure that when he signed the open contract, had no idea that Papashango would be the opposition he'd have to face.
He don't know what to do. He don't know whether to stay or whether to leave.
There it is.
Uh-oh.
There's that look we've seen before.
I'll see you, Monsoon. I'm gonna
catch you. Oh, look at that.
Oh, my goodness.
All four corners both burst into flame. And look at that black.
Look at
that brown, gooey stuff running down the face of this youngster.
Where's it coming from?
It's coming from his scalp.
I know, but why? How? Who?
I don't know.
Well, you go. I'm not.
You. Forget it. What's that stuff running down your face?
That's sweat.
Oh, that is sweat. Look at the look on the kisser of that youngster. He's out of there, and rightly so. Everyone just mesmerized. We'll be back right after this.
I'm out of here.
In possessing the powers that you have, Papa Shango, then you must see the force of warriors that do believe surround me. And placing your curse upon those that do not believe, Papa Shango, only makes you weaker. This warrior says, take I, let me sacrifice my flesh so I can walk only as a skeleton. If, Papa Shango, I stand only as a skeleton, I still stand as the skeleton of the ultimate warrior!
Ramon. Razor Ramon. I come from the gutter. I know that. I got no education. Who needs it? Look at me. Look at me. Look at the gold. Look at my clothes. I'm a success. I'm coming to the WWF. All I want is what I got coming to me. The world, Chico. Everything in it.
We've been fortunate enough to catch up with the World Wrestling Federation champion, the Macho Man, Randy Savage.
Ooh, yeah!
And I thank you, Macho Man, for
no
your time.
No problem.
As you can see, the arena is empty right now. However, in just a few short hours, it's going to be standing room only as you, Randy Savage, defend the World Wrestling Federation title in front of a packed house. At the risk of sounding negative, however,
what is?
Let's address the accusations, the allegations that persist. From Mr. Perfect, from Ric Flair, that, well, you kind of had to bend the rules to get the World Wrestling Federation title.
Bend the rules!
Now, that doesn't shock me because I've watched you your entire career, and there has always been a cloud of controversy hanging over your head.
What it is, Mean Gene Okerlund. Yes, I have bent the rules a time or two. And I reserve the right to do it in the future, yeah. Because when I wrestle people like that, yes, I'm a survivor. And I don't apologize for that at all. Now, when I wrestle scientific wrestlers, I can do it that style, too. And I can keep my World Wrestling Federation championship belt. But when I know ahead of time, not being naive, Mean Gene Okerlund, I've never been that.
No?
Never been that. That a person is the dirtiest player to ever play the game, then I do what I have to do. So that at the end, the bottom line is that I walk out with the World Wrestling Federation championship belt. And that's what's important to me right now. Shot through the heart and you're to blame. Brother, you give love a bad name. Ric Flair, I'm talking to you. I'm going to bring you all the way down if you come after the madness, because I'm the type of person not to forget anything in this world. I take it all the way to the grave, Mean Gene Okerlund. I'm very serious. Every time I wake up in the morning, I'm the World Wrestling Federation champion, and Ric Flair, you're not. Mr. Perfect, tell Ric Flair what I just said, because reading between the lines doesn't happen to help Ric Flair. He doesn't understand me when I talk. No, he doesn't. He's got to understand that the Macho Man Randy Savage is bad to the bone, yeah. And I got a heart made of stone right now, and I'm living on the edge of a lightning bolt, and I do not apologize for that. No, I don't. I'm the World Wrestling Federation champion, and Ric Flair, you are not.
Wait a minute, Macho Man. Do I understand you correctly? Are you telling me, are you telling our vast television audience that you will do whatever it takes, including breaking the rules?
Absolutely.
To continue your successful reign?
You're right about that, yeah. I will rock you, Ric Flair, and there's nothing that you can do about it. No, I'm the World Wrestling Federation champion, and you're not. And that is the bottom line. Ooh, yeah!
Hello?
Is
this the Big Boss Man?
Yes.
Big Boss Man, this is Mr. Perfect. Don't hang up right now. I'm a broadcast journalist. We are on the air. I have a question for you.
What is it?
I would like to know, how did it feel when Nails gave you the worst beating in the history of the WWF?
It was rough.
It was rough. Well, I, for one, Boss Man, am happy that your career is finally over.
I'm gonna be back.
You're gonna be back? You're coming back to take more of a beating from Nails? You're even stupider than I thought. Goodbye.
I can't believe...
Savage, you can say and do anything you want to win a match, but you cannot beat the expertise of Rick.
Macho Man, you're living on borrowed time. You're walking my aisle. You're styling and profiling in my shoes and wearing my title belt. Macho Man, don't you know it's my destiny to be the WWF champion again? Woo!
We're back with more WWF action.
The following contest.
Oh boy. Who knows what evil lurks? Look at this. Papa Shango. He's made a lot of believers.
Shango!
Out of a lot of fans and indeed a lot of wrestlers.
Some people can't even look on.
Well, you don't know what's going to happen. I mean, with this guy, who would sign on? I mean, you really have to have some guts to sign on as a competitor of this Papa Shango.
If I had a choice, McMahon, I guess I would take not to wrestle this man.
Yeah, I would think so. But the Ultimate Warrior, no doubt, looming in the future.
Coming down the aisle from Baltimore, Maryland.
Uh-oh, who's this?
Weighing 231 pounds, Chris.
A very reluctant opponent, I might add, Chris Hahn.
Well, after you've seen what's gone on the last couple weeks, McMahon, wouldn't you be a little cautious, too?
Yeah, I think I would, no doubt about it. Looks like Chris Hahn is having second thoughts, justifiably so, as to entering the ring here with Papa Shango. And there, you see on the cover of the WWF magazine, which is available in newsstands all over. There you see the Ultimate Warrior. You talk about a man who will step front and center, a man with perhaps some say more guts than brains. The Ultimate Warrior, despite what has happened to him with Papa Shango, will step right up and spit in Papa Shango's face and go at it tooth and nail. That's the kind of competitor the Ultimate Warrior is.
That's stupid, McMahon. All of those things that have happened to the Ultimate Warrior with the evil goo and everything else, you best be just staying away from Papa Shango.
Well, again, now it appears as though Chris Hahn is on the inside of the ring, and officially I would suspect the match will be underway shortly. Everyone looking on. Very, very reluctant Chris Hahn. Very reluctant looking over at Papa Shango.
Wait a minute, his hand's on fire! His hand is on fire!
Where did that come from now?
Which way? His hand is on fire! Stop, get it out! That's gonna be burning his flesh! His hand is on fire! Oh my goodness, look at this poor young man!
How do you explain that, McMahon?
I can't explain it! This poor young man who came to the ring with such trepidation, and look what happened to him! Big attendance, look at this!
It's the spell, it's the curse of Papa Shango! Strikes again!
I can't believe it! Who is this? What's going on? The poor young man! This guy is sick! He's sick!
Ladies and gentlemen, my guest this week, accompanied by Sensational Sherry, here is Shawn Michaels!
I think he's cute! He's so sexy! He's got the look!
Take a look at this, won't you?
I am looking.
What do we see? The front and back of Shawn Michaels, he calls it a mirror. Geez, Gene Okerlund is lucky to see his reflection in the mirror, too.
I don't even know if he has one.
Michaels.
You've got to be kidding me. You're having Sherry carry around a mirror so you could admire yourself? Sherry, don't you think that's a little vain?
Mirror, mirror in my hand. Who is the sexiest man in the land?
Oh, I am looking at him. I'm sorry, did you say vain? I thought I heard vain.
Wait a minute, I think I alluded to vanity, yes.
Did you say vain, Gene Okerlin? Is it vain to want to look at what everybody in the World Wrestling Federation is talking about? I don't think so. I mean, come on now. I mean, really, who can blame them? Take a look at that. Is that not the hottest thing you have ever, ever laid eyes on?
Oh, it's on fire, all right.
You know, Mean Gene, Shawn Michaels is without a doubt the sexiest and hottest man in the World Wrestling Federation. But besides that, besides all of that, do you want to know what else I see?
Whoa, wait a minute. What in the world do you see in here?
What I see right now is the next Intercontinental Champion.
Me too.
Speaking of Bret the Hitman Hart, Shawn Michaels, you will have an opportunity to become the Intercontinental Champion here in the World Wrestling Federation. And I suggest that that would be the opportunity of a lifetime for you.
Why would a guy that looks like that worry one bit about Bret the Hitman? Give me a break. You know something? I am really surprised. I gotta be honest with you. I'm surprised that they didn't beef up security here today. I mean, the people could be tearing down the barricades at any minute.
After all, Shawn Michaels is still in the building, right?
That's right. After all, Shawn Michaels is in the building. But you know, before long, Shawn Michaels won't need this mirror to see his reflection. No siree. I'll be looking at my reflection in the shiny new Intercontinental belt. Hey, did you hear that, Gene?
Yeah.
You hear all those screams? And you hear those screams? I'm telling you what, this may not be safe. They could be tearing down the barricades at any minute. All these ladies here are going to be crashing the barricades just to get a chance.
What if we can conduct the remainder of this interview?
No. In the interest of my own personal safety, I think it's time that Shawn Michaels leave the building. But, before I go, I just want to say one thing. Here's looking at you, kid.
He's the most conceited individual I believe I have ever seen, but he could be the next Intercontinental Champion. We take you now, ladies and gentlemen, to Miami.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming my guest this week, accompanied by his manager, Jimmy Hart. Here is the Mountie. Everybody, come on. Shock Ogre when you're not going to see his hair stand up.
Just sit right down and keep quiet.
Jimmy Hart, you should be getting used to directing orchestras.
Let me tell you something, Mean Gene. Sergeant Slaughter, baby, found out the hard way that the Mountie always gets his man.
I want to get a pair of shorts, pal, that fit. Mountie, the question is, recently in front of a national television audience, you had the unmitigated gall to interfere when Sergeant Slaughter would put that away. When Sergeant Slaughter was beating an opponent, you interfered in that match, and you shocked Sergeant Slaughter with that very shotgun. As a matter of fact, you rendered the man unconscious. What were you thinking about?
Now, wait. I heard, Sergeant Slaughter, that lately you've been doing a lot of chin-ups.
What do you mean by that?
Okay. I didn't hear about it, but it's written all over your face.
Wait a minute. Forget that kind of horseplay.
Okay, you want me to get serious? I'll get serious. You know what I don't like about Slaughter?
What's that?
I don't like, Slaughter, the fact that you're coming out nationwide.
A military man. That's his way.
Do you know who I am?
Tell him.
I am the bounty. And Slaughter, you're nothing but a sergeant. And the only man around here that's gonna get attention is me. And you know how?
Uh-oh. Fry him.
To see him take that shock stick and burn the hair off Walker and Bliss.
Curling the ring, weighing at 220 pounds, here is Dan Robbins. And his opponent.
Look at that. He's got the big boss man's club.
The ring, weighing in at 302 pounds, here is Nail.
A hush has sort of fallen over this arena.
Everyone is just awed, this man.
As this convicted felon makes his way down to the ring.
He was an innocent man. He was framed.
How do you know that?
I heard he was framed.
You heard. Do you have any documents to prove that?
I'm going to work on it.
Yeah.
He's got the boss man's own knife stick. Look at this.
I'm going to find out what this guy was in for.
Knowing the big boss man.
Guarantee it wasn't forgery.
Probably jaywalking, and he just took advantage of the guy. Look at that.
He is a powerhouse. I guess those prison groceries agreed with him.
It may have been 400 pounds. Who knows?
Look at that. Trying to rip open the face.
I mean,
Dan Robbins.
You see the pictures last week? I mean, he beat the boss, man. He gave him the worst beating anyone in the World Wrestling Federation has ever received.
Yeah, but what did the boss man say, Brain? I'll be back.
Yeah, but you know as well as I, if he's that dumb to even try to come back, he's not going to be 100%. And when Nails worked him over before, he was 100%. Now, if Nails gets his hands on him again, it could be curtains for the big boss man. He'd be going up the river for the last time, pal.
Don't you think that he knows that? Don't you think that he's got any pride?
Oh, look at those kicks. This man doesn't care about anybody. Shows no expression on his face. He is just one cruel individual.
Yeah, especially when he can get you while you're not looking.
Now what's he going to do?
Oh, what an awesome display of power. I don't think I've ever seen that before.
This Robbins has no idea where he's at.
He's in dreamland right now.
The most humane thing you could have done, ref, is ring that bell.
Nails!
That's the name he got when he was up at the big house, Nails.
Now what's his real name?
Well, he didn't get that because he's a carpenter. He's got nice toes.
You don't know, do you, Frank? You're skirting the question. There's the big boss man's nightstick.
Hey, boss man used to do that, and you liked it. Now the shoe's on the other foot.
Take a look at what this sadistic individual... is doing to this youngster. He hasn't shown me brain, any wrestling skills. It's just brute force that this convicted felon is annihilating people with. He's terrifying. I'll tell you, he's just one big, tough, rugged man. He doesn't care if he wins or loses. He doesn't care about the rules. I doubt if he knows all the rules. I'm surprised he's leaving. He's just sadistic. No expression on his face. Who knows what's going through that warped mind after spending who knows how many days in solitary confinement, what that could do to you mentally. And think, he's an innocent man. Please. Event Center coming up. Here we go.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome a great patriot in any country. Here's Sergeant Slaughter. Forget that recently, right in the middle of your match, who should come down to ringside and interfere but the Mountie himself. As a matter of fact, I vividly recall seeing him coming down with what he calls the Great American Scream Machine, that big shock stick of his, and he almost rendered you unconscious, Sergeant.
Mountie! The Royal Mountain Maggot! You Dudley Do Wrong! By now, billions of people have seen what you tried to do to Sergeant Slaughter. You deliberately tried to injure Sergeant Slaughter with that electrocution machine of yours. You deliberately tried to put Sergeant Slaughter out of professional wrestling. You deliberately tried to end the existence, to destroy the existence of Sergeant Slaughter. You tried, Mountie, but you did succeed. No, you did not. I, Sergeant Slaughter, am a survivor. I always have been, always will be. Mountie, you Dudley Do Wrong. You and I are both men of the uniform. I, Sergeant Slaughter, wear my uniform proudly. You, maggot, are a disgrace to your uniform and your country. And being men of the uniform, being men of the military, you should know the two famous fighting words, Semper Fidelis, Semper Fi, always faithful, always prepared. And Mountie, the Royal Mountain Maggot, you had better be prepared, because the next time I get you on the battleground, I'm deliberately going to hit you with a slaughter cannon, and I'm going to deliberately put you in the Cobra Clutch, and I'm going to squeeze, Maggot, I'm going to squeeze until we don't have to hear you yell, I'm gonna scream, take any prisoners. And that, Maggot, that Dudley Do Wrong is an order.
The Longhouse and other Native American dwellings. Then later, down by the river, he took the time to dwell upon the inner spirit that stokes the fire deep within this Native American superstar. Also discovered that when your name is Tatanka, your time is not always your own. Enthusiastic fans surrounded him at every turn. But, as always, Tatanka found the time to reiterate that Native American message of family, community, peace, and pride.
All of you know what Eagle Feathers stand for. Eagle Feathers are the highest honor that a Native American can have. These feathers were handed down to me by great-great-great-grandfathers. So Rick the Model Martel, as far as he's concerned, I'm going to come after him full blast as far as Tatanka and make him very, very extinct in the World Wrestling Federation. You know, what I like to close on, you know, which is very, very important, you know, again, you know, all of us here, I want to thank you very, very much for having me here, the adults, the young kids. Again, the youth right here, this is our future here. I want to make sure that, you know, everything that you do as far as school, make sure that you stay in school, make sure that you stay away from all the bad things in life, which are drugs, alcohol. These are the things that are the negative things in our life. They will not get you to where you want to be a winner or the goals that you want in life. So make sure you do all the right things. Make sure you obey your mother and father. Make sure you obey your elders. Very, very important. And most important, remember where your bloodlines is, Native American, because that's what I stand for. Every day when I wake up, every day when I go to bed, that is on my mind all the time. That's what I symbolize in the World Wrestling Federation. Anybody that does not know what my red hair symbolizes, the red hair symbolizes the bloodline of all Indian nations. So this is something that's very sacred to me. So remember where you come from and be very, very proud that you're Native American.
Well, home ain't looking too good right now, Paul.
Home's a mess.
I never would imagine the place that we live and grew up in would turn into a burnt-out, cockroach-infested slum.
That's what I've been trying to tell you. That's where this has all began. This is where your lives began. This is your past.
Look at this.
This is where you determine where the future lies, from your past. We are products of our environment. This is where you grew up, in these neighborhoods.
You know something, Paul? You ain't never lied to us. What you say is the truth.
It is a mess.
Look at it.
Ain't nothing left. Look at it. Nothing left but charred memories. I remember this back room here. Oh, you can't even get back in now.
What's this? What is this?
Oh, it ain't what is this. That's Rocco. Remember that guy we told you about?
Holy buck.
Look at this.
In this whole place of mess, this charred remains, you pick up some that are our past. Where'd you find him?
I can't believe this. This is the guy we toasted to all these nights. Every night. Here's
Mr. Rocco, and you never knew who he was.
Paul, remember, we were little kids. I kept telling you, remember? I said, we were little kids. The great little Legion of Doomers play with now. All the little hawk and animal wrestling buddies. All those dolls everybody knocks down and beats up. This is our wrestling buddy right here. Rocco, when we were little kids, when I didn't want to talk to my parents or I couldn't find Hawk, I'd tell this guy what was going on, and he'd set me straight and tell me what was right and what was wrong.
You know, Rocco's the guy that taught you to be a team. He taught the animal and the hawk to be a team. He was your teacher in the school of hard knocks.
I remember you telling me that.
Yeah, Paul, he ain't looking too good right now. He needs some work.
You know, this is the best thing that ever happened. I really like this. I think this is the best thing to ever happen to the Legion of Doom. Rocco, let me bring Rocco to the ring so that you will never forget your past.
Let's bring him everywhere with us.
Let's clean him up.
Let's do it now.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming my guest this week, along with his manager, Mr. Fuji. Here is the Berserker.
Talk about the elevator not going all the way to the top.
Yeah, he's a little different.
Tried to make a shish kebab out of the Undertaker.
All right, Mr. Fuji, before I get to the Berserker, you know, the way this man has been acting in the World Wrestling Federation, it makes all kinds of sense. Because I recall your actions, your deeds through the years. First as a world-class wrestler, and now as a manager. Tell you the truth, Mr. Fuji, I don't think we've seen anything yet. Maybe only the tip of the iceberg.
Let me tell you, Gene Oakland, it's Master Fuji.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
And let me tell you, my Berserker is the meanest, toughest wrestler in the world. And every wrestler will have to go to my Berserker first. And not one has succeeded. And that includes you, Undertaker.
Speaking of the Undertaker, Berserker, I cannot help but recall vividly what happened when all of a sudden you blindsided the Undertaker with your shield. And then after that, you tried to impale him with this very sword. If that wasn't enough, outside of the ring, you removed the padding and you drove the Undertaker headfirst into that hard concrete. I've got to ask you, Berserker, when does all of this nonsense end?
Undertaker, you talk softly.
Well, I talk loud. I burp loud. I even smell loud. And I've got something that can stop you. They say you sleep in a coffin. Well, I lay awake at night just thinking of ways to bust you up. Undertaker, next time when I peel that mat back on the floor and I run your ugly head into the cold, hard cement, you're not gonna get up. And then you're gonna receive a proper Viking burial by me impaling my sword into your cold, white, ugly, stinking, nappy flesh. And then, you know what we're gonna have, Fuji? Cold cut.
Wait a minute. Did you say cold cuts?
Yes, boy, stop.
You say cold cut?
Look at that sword, sharp as a razor.
No, I'll tell you, it's sharper than that. Because you know how tough a cheap tie is to cut through, and all he wears are cheap ties.
You ought to know.
Huh?
he can take a beating and keeps coming back. I've always admired Paul Bearer, the way he guides this man, and what's in that urn and the strength he gets from it.
Oh, wait, I've never said anything to Rocky.
Hillbilly, you remember what he said last week?
I don't remember anything like that coming out of your mouth last week.
I think it was like, no pain, no brain.
No,
I said, no pain, and Slick said, no brain, meaning me. That's where you picked up that from.
Weasel out of those comments you made.
Slick.
Well, he's not here tomorrow.
Well, you're just going to take my word for it then, pal.
I mean, your word.
I'll tell you what let's do. Let's take you back now. We have it on videotape. Let's take you back and show you exactly.
You can't do this to me.
Let's roll the tape and show you exactly what you said.
Don't roll the tape. It's my show. Don't roll it.
The Undertakers we were talking about earlier on, The Undertaker surely has his work cut out for him. Wouldn't you say, Bobby Heenan?
Well, he's just a big dummy, and he's led around by that Paul Bearer. Sure, maybe the man feels no pain. But you know that old saying, no brain, no pain.
Well, Bobby Heenan, why don't you explain yourself?
I can explain myself. Real simple. But I know what you've done, and I know what you've done with the director and the producer. You've gotten back there, and somehow you've dubbed those tapes, or you edited them, or you made it look like I said those things. You turned everything around just because you're jealous of me, and you want that gigantic Undertaker to come in here and put those cold hands around my neck.
Oh, yes.
You need a little luck, don't you, buddy?
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, it appears as though your luck has just run out. Joining us now, ladies and gentlemen.
No.
Yes, here he comes for the very first time.
You've got to tell me that you didn't.
Being led by Paul Bearer, here is The Undertaker.
You've got it.
Hey, Paul, how's things going?
Paul Bearer, his very first appearance here on WWF Primetime.
You and I have never had words. I've always admired your work. I've always admired how you manage The Undertaker. I've always thought very highly of The Undertaker. The man has enormous abilities. The man is impervious to pain. And I'd be the last person. I would be the last person on the face of this earth that would ever say anything about that man. You've got to take my word for it. Please.
Oh, Mr. Heenan, The Undertaker is always closer than you think. Oh, yes, he is.
Well, keep him back there. Don't bring him out here, because believe me. McMahon, you got to tell him what you did. You got to tell him what you did, how you turned those tapes around, trying to make a fool out of me.
I didn't do anything. I didn't do a thing. You did everything.
Well, then you tell him, pal, because I'm getting the H out of here.
You stay away from me.
I never said those things. You got to believe me. Have a chair. Sit down here. You'll enjoy yourself. Have a glass of water. Cold drink. A real cold drink. You got to believe me. I never said nothing.
No brain, no pain.
Get up. Tell him. Tell him, Paul, please do something. Yeah. I'm getting on.
Let's take you now, ladies and gentlemen, to action involving Bret the Hitman Hart. Where are you going?
We're back with more WWF Primetime, and Bobby the Brain Heenan has just been persuaded to have a seat. Tell him.
Yeah.
Tell him what?
Tell him this. I'm not going any place. I'm not going to do nothing. I'm just going to sit here. I'm not going to say a word.
I think you just told him. And, Mr. Undertaker, we do have your special chair right over here.
Yeah.
I was brought in specially just for you, sir. You can just have a seat right here next to Paul Bearer. And Bobby Heenan, if you would just, like, please stay away from me, I would greatly appreciate it.
Yeah, just be yourself, Bobby.
Yeah, there you go. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, we just saw an update on Tatanka. Tatanka unquestionably has his problems with the model Rick Martel. Would you say, Bobby Heenan?
Yeah, Tatanka. But Martel's going to have a lot of problems from Tatanka. Because you know that great American Indian wrestler, Tatanka, he had his feathers swiped by Martel, and he's going to get even for it.
But Martel's a great wrestler, Bob.
Well, you're entitled to your opinion, just like I'm entitled to mine.
Hey, whoa, wait just one minute.
Yeah, wait a minute.
What? This is a changed Bobby Heenan.
You've
always knocked Tatanka. You've always praised the model Rick Martel.
Yeah, be yourself.
Well, the model is a great athlete, but Tatanka, he's great.
Why are you seeing things so different this week, Bobby?
No reason. It's like I am here every week. Just being me.
I don't think so, Vince.
Well, we'll get a comment from The Undertaker, hopefully, but right now, let's get comments from Sergeant Slaughter. He does his commentary in the squared circle.
Ladies and gentlemen, my guest at this time is the former prison inmate, Nails.
Well,
You know, Nails, recently, upon your release from your incarceration, you arrived here in the World Wrestling Federation and administered what I'd have to say is one of the worst beatings in WWF history. Now, the unfortunate recipient of that violent act was none other than the Big Boss Man.
Boss Man! Who's the boss now, Boss Man? That was the first beating in a long line of beatings. You're in my prison now, and I've thrown away the key.
Well, in all due respect, Nails, I've got to tell you, the Big Boss Man is no prisoner of yours. As a matter of fact, he's going to be back, and if I know the Big Boss Man, he's looking forward to locking up with you.
Boss Man, there are no bars between us anymore. No more handcuffs. No more leg irons! The system cannot protect you anymore! If you come back, I'm gonna hunt you down! And there's nothing you can do about it! And no one can stop me! Now! It's your turn to serve hard time!
You don't want to miss Body Stars. And
oh, bodies?
You don't want to miss Body Stars here on USA every week. However, ladies and gentlemen, Body Stars will return in 2 weeks' time at a new time. That's Saturday mornings at 10 o'clock. You can catch Body Stars every Saturday morning at 10 o'clock. Unquestionably, Paul Bear's favorite show.
I love that word, body. Oh, yes.
Right now, let's take you to action involving the British Bulldog.
Championship here in the World Wrestling Federation has to be contested every 30 days. And what a lucky break for Skinner.
Yes, indeed, because I don't think he was listed at the top of the logical contenders. I can think of a couple of men who might take precedence over him. However, don't deny him his day. This is his moment. And, you know, it might be his moment to go down in history, too, as a successful challenger who became the champion.
I think it's just going to be his moment to go down. How despicable could it be to have someone like Skinner representing the World Wrestling Federation as our champion?
Could you be a little more positive with that opinion?
Give me a break.
Oh, gosh. Well, now I agree with you. That is the most horrible, despicable thing I've seen. That's in his eyes.
Filthy, disgusting.
Oh, golly, this fellow is repulsive. He smells, too. Oh, gosh, I don't like looking at that.
Somebody
even.
Get a towel in there or something.
Oh, gosh, that's all. The referee should stop this and get his face cleaned off. Give him a fair chance.
And that's one of our better referees in there, too. One of our top-class referees.
Come on! Get him! Come on!
Skinner pulling out all the stops here. Realizing what a tremendous opportunity this is for him.
Well, he's certainly showing off very well here in the opening minutes of this match. We're 2 or 3 minutes into it, and it looks as if Skinner is already a prospective champion. He's got the bearing, he's got the way to do it, and he's got the despicability, according to you, Gorilla, to win this match, too.
I'd like to see him drummed right out of the World Wrestling Federation and let him go back to doing commercials for Red Man or something.
Oh, golly. Well, I know you don't like him, Gorilla, and that, you made that very evident.
What's to like about the guy, Alfred?
I know you'll have nothing to do with him in the dressing room area. You pass him by, you don't acknowledge him at all. One day he's going to strike you, Gorilla.
Oh, gosh!
Rammed the head first right into the steel steps.
Golly, golly, golly. Oh, this is the end of Macho Man. I think his reign is coming to an end. Look at him, look. He can't see. His eyes are closed up. He hit his chin there on that solid steel step. And he's really in bad, bad trouble.
Macho Man Randy Savage knows what adversity is all about, knows what it takes to be a champion, has survived here in the World Wrestling Federation as the champion, as the challenger, and now again as the champion. And it's going to take a lot more than a pig like Skinner to strip him of that coveted WWF title. It's only my personal opinion.
Now, yes, it's a very positive one, isn't it? You don't leave any
room. As it may be. No,
you don't leave any room for doubt at all. Now, watch out, Skinner. You'll get yourself disqualified. That's a foolish move. And I didn't expect Skinner to do that. He's not a fool.
Well, he showed me a moment ago that he might have had some smarts because he went outside the ring, threw the Macho Man back inside, knowing he can't win the title on a countout or disqualification. It has to be a pinfall or submission in order for that belt to change hands.
And I think he's awfully close to that. A little spirited comeback here by the champion, but I don't think it's to any avail. I don't think it's going to last.
Oh, I hope he swallowed his tobacco. Macho Man now unloading, starting to find the range here. Probably got some sight back.
Well, the first couple of blows were a little bit off the target, but he certainly closed him off the target. As you said, he found the range with the last three. Are they sufficient, though, to stop a hardy man like Skinner? What's he doing now?
He's going to disrobe.
I hope not.
He took his belt off. He's obviously going to use that as a weapon. Hey, referee, turn around. Take a look.
Oh, that's, I can hear those heavy blows resounding all over the stadium.
Oh. You're looking right at him, ref. Do something.
It's resounding all the way through Cornwall, all the way through Canada, into America. Look at this.
Well, the Macho Man now with the belt. He's going to hang him out to dry.
Oh, what a terrible backfiring this is on Skinner.
No, the old saying, Albert, you fool with the bull, you get the horns.
Yes, I think that is definitely so. You play with fire, you get burnt, huh?
Absolutely. You can bet without any hesitation that the executive consultant is watching along with Bobby the Brain Heenan and along with Ric Flair.
Oh, of that there's absolutely no doubt. Ric Flair, I saw him the other week, and he's absolutely obsessed with the idea of getting his hands on this man, the champion, and prizing that belt away from him. The executive consultant has the same obsession. I don't know about Heenan. Is he obsessed as they are?
What, are you kidding? It's his meal ticket.
Then he must be obsessed too, even more so. He hit it with the claw.
Look at that little claw or hoof or whatever it is.
A piece of the alligator went into action there, and he's got him. He's down.
Two count now.
Oh, so close.
Thought we might have had a disqualification moments ago as the Macho Man brought a steel chair into the referee and then reluctantly turned it loose. Pile driver, yes.
Oh, really well executed. executed. He's got it this time, surely. Surely even the champion got it. Yes,
he
did.
That nonchalant cover.
Oh, that is so bad.
Backwoods cover.
What a cavalier move that was on the part of him. What is he trying to do now? Humiliate the champion?
You don't do that. He had an opportunity. He let it pass him by, proving that alligator men are not too clever.
Well, not there. I did think he had those smarts you were talking about a little while ago. And he certainly threw the champion back in to try and get a clean 1-2-3. But now he's wasted several great opportunities.
He does some nice things in the ring. He makes some nice moves, as is obvious by moments ago, that nice shoulder breaker and how it was executed. But then he has lapses of memory.
Yes, he does. And that was a very nice pile driver he executed too. But he finished that off with that cavalier cover, that very nonchalant, as you described it, trying to pin move on Randy. But Savage, I believe, is beginning to get a bit more back into this. What, look at his eyes. You can see them now. They cleared a bit. They're becoming
clear. Here comes that patented neck breaker that he puts all his opponents away with. Whether that's enough to take care of the champ, we'll find out. Two count only as he left the back door open, and the Macho Man just slid right out of there. What are you blaming the referee for? It's not his fault.
No, I must applaud the courage and the absolute tenacity of the champion. He's hanging on to his title by all means that he knows how to. And unfortunately, although this match has not gone the way he wished it would have gone, he's still managing to survive. What do you think? Do you think he didn't have sufficient training or preparation or what?
I don't think that the Macho Man Randy Savage figured this match, number one, to go this long, Alfred.
No.
Number two, to have this kind of offense come out of this pig skinner.
Really, you mustn't keep calling him that.
Oh.
That's very nasty. But as I said to you before, Skinner told me he'd had nothing else but this match in mind for weeks. He'd been training very, very hard indeed. And it's
Oh, dear.
An incredible error there. What a mistake.
Almost castrated himself, Alfred.
Yes, he would have been no good as a pig then for the slaughterhouse.
Look out, Macho Man going up to the top where he's most comfortable. Perhaps that patented elbow. Yes, finds the mark. So long, Pig Skinner.
The Macho Man, Randy Savage, the reigning World Wrestling Federation champion, and unquestionably the Macho Man will go down in the annals of history as one of the greatest WWF champions of all time. And you know what? Ric Flair's reign was, sort of curtailed by the Macho Man, Randy Savage. And many say it's doubtful that Ric Flair will once again wear the World Wrestling Federation championship. What do you think, Bobby Heenan?
Why do you always go to me? Interview these gentlemen, please.
Well, no, it's almost like we're sort of intrigued by this new, honest Bobby.
Well, I'm just a broadcast journalist, and I'm just Flair's financial advisor.
He's doing all right, isn't he, Flair? I mean, in terms of finances.
Oh, he's doing great. Yeah, but okay. Talk to him.
What do you want to know, McMahon? Yeah, I'll answer your questions.
Well, again, don't you feel as though the Macho Man Randy Savage has certain superiorities compared to Ric Flair, Bobby Heenan?
Well, that's like judging.
Not at all.
Are you kidding me?
Bobby.
Wait, whoa. Bobby, come on.
Flair is a tremendous athlete.
Right. There's no question about that.
So is Savage. I mean, Savage is the man packing the gold right now. You just got to be honest.
So you're saying he's better than him?
I didn't say he was better. I didn't say he was worse.
What's he saying there, Perfect?
I didn't say
anything. I don't know what he's saying.
Go ask somebody else, will you?
I see.
All right. I get it. Hello.
Hello. Right now, let's take you to to Razor Ramon. Do you know Razor Ramon?
Super.
We're back with more WWF Primetime Wrestling, back with Paul Bearer and The Undertaker. And no doubt, an individual knocking on The Undertaker's door, so to speak, is the Berserker.
Oh, yes. For the death of you, Berserker, I can understand why. Why you would try to stab my Undertaker with your sword. Do you know what's going to happen to you and Mr. Fuji? You're going out, oh yes, right to the cemetery.
Berserker, you've knocked on the door. But on the other side of the door stands the Reaper. If the Reaper doesn't come calling on you, you don't call on the Reaper. Rest in peace, Berserker. Fuji. Rest.
Right here on WWF Prime Time next week, in addition to which, joining us, ladies and gentlemen, will be the one, will be the only, the reigning WWF champion, Macho Man Randy Savage, right here.
Yeah,
and by the way, Bobby Heenan, I must say that, I've enjoyed you this week. This has been refreshing.
Me too. It's been so nice, best for a change.
Well, you know, sometimes you look at things different when time goes by, you know. Ever comments I made before concerning people just maybe weren't right. And it just feels good to sit here and no one's ever patted me on the back before.
Really? So this is the new, the honest Bobby Heenan.
The way I'm going to be from now on. I'm going to be positive and not going to be negative. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to con. I'm not going to swerve. I'm not going to cheat. I'm just going to go forward. Go forward and be a better person.
I see. Well, if that's the case, then we have him?
Yep.
All right, why don't you tune in here? We just happened to pick up a few comments that you and Perfect were talking during the commercial break. Let's just take a look at this. Here, look right there. Let's take a look at this.
Bear with me. The show's almost over. See those two freaks are leaving to go back to the cemetery. We can coast against you.
I got it.
Thanks, go on. All right.
Yeah. Well.
There you go.
He's dumped something in there again. No, please. No, wait just a minute. Please.
Now, you've done it now, Bobby Heenan. You can't get out of this one.
Stop him.
You've done it now.
Perfect. Stop him, Perfect.
Here he comes. Put the chair.
Undertaker.
Put the chair. Nothing's going to stop the Undertaker.
You need to
help me come out.
Oh, I never did that. I never did that. Turn this off. Turn this off now. He's going to be gone now. He's not going to be able to stop
Undertaker.
No, he likes Bobby.
He's got to get his
paws. No, he likes Bobby.
Bobby the Brand Heenan. Mr. Perfect, we'll see you next week. We'll see you next week on WWF.
Thank you.